Now they should be able to hear us. Can you hear us out there? Make sure you can see our please stand by and you can hear us. Let us know.
Hello.
We're getting ready to start.
Happy Sunday.
Ready?
And yeah, we're talking. Okay. Richard says that. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Here we are. We're all good. Right. Hey, everybody.
Hey, Michael.
And welcome. Welcome. We are here again for episode number 201 of our button show. What does this button do? It's an educational show about smartphones and technology with us, Geeks On Tour. Today's beginner's lesson is about what to do with old smartphones. But we have a favorite tip, huh, Chris?
We're going to give you the best tip right away.
Oh, okay.
And this is about using IV cam to turn an old phone into a webcam or a document camera. That's how I use it.
Hi, I'm Chris Gould with Geeks On Tour, and I am talking today to the teachers out there, the people who teach others how to use smartphones. And when you either record videos or you do a live presentation over the computer, you need to be able to show a phone screen on the computer screen. Now, there are ways to just share the screen from the phone to the computer using things like TeamViewer or connecting your phone onto a Zoom call and doing screen sharing. But then you don't see the fingers. I think it's really important, especially for newbies, to see what your fingers are doing on the phone. So for that, we've always used something called a document camera. If you've watched our Geeks On Tour videos and you've seen videos of a phone screen being demonstrated, it's because we have this document camera. This is a camera that points down. It's connected to the computer via a USB, and it acts as a separate camera to the computer. So it is seeing all the finger movements. But this is a $180 device. If you have an old phone laying around, it can do the same thing. So if your phone is a camera, number one, you need to be able to have it pointing down. And number two, you need to be able to have the camera viewing on the computer. So here's how we do it now. This is just a stand. Can you see that? It's a stand that holds the phone. So this is my old iPhone. This is my new iPhone. The old iPhone, then, I don't really need anymore. I can use it like a document camera. So this stand holds it in place. Now I need to put it onto the camera to show whatever is underneath it. But just the regular camera won't work because it has all that other stuff around it, you know, the flash and a piece of software called iVCam. So iVCam is both an app on the phone, and notice that it pops right up and shows what is underneath it. And you need to realize that the lens on this phone, the camera lens, is like right there. So you got to get that positioned right. And then on the computer, there is also a companion software called iVCam, and you run that. Now, how is the computer going to be seeing what's on the phone? There's two ways. What I have right now is just using the Wi-Fi. The phone is connected to our household Wi-Fi. The computer is connected to our household Wi-Fi. The phone is running IV cam. The computer is running IV cam. So now, whatever I do on the phone can be seen on the computer, and I can be recording what's on the computer as I teach how to use the phone. You can also, if you don't have a good enough Wi-Fi, you can plug it in to USB. So you can have a cable connection to the computer. I prefer the Wi-Fi for two reasons. Number one, you're not always getting power to your phone by connecting the USB to your computer. So if I don't connect to the computer, I can keep the phone powered by having it plugged in just to a power connector. Secondly, if I'm on the Wi-Fi, I can take this phone out of the holder, walk around, and be a roving reporter with the phone as a camera. Another reason that I really like this over and above, I mean, not only can you use a phone instead of a $180 document camera, but I think the phone is better. Watch this. Can you zoom in and say, if I want to show something really in detail, I can zoom in on the phone and show magnified detail of what is happening on the phone. So that's how you can use an old phone as a fancy document camera for teaching smartphones or anything that you would want to demonstrate in real life.
Oh, cool. Yeah. Oh, it's really good. I like that. Such good camera work, too, don't you think?
Now, there's, you know, we, of course, just show it working well. Every system that you use will have some glitches. No. I find that I have to reboot fairly regularly to get these things to work well. But that is the system I've been using to teach the Google Photos classes over Zoom. And I really like it. I think it's real clear, especially the ability to zoom in, as I use that when I'm teaching on a live streaming basis.
Yeah. Well, let's see. Richard wants to know if it works on both Android and iOS. Yes.
Yes, I have not tried it on the Android yet, though.
I have, and it works.
The IV cam?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And there are others. There's one called Droid Cam. It works on iOS and Android, too. But this is just the one that we kind of settled on. It had good reviews, and we wanted to support it. I thought it was a good thing. Yeah. Stan looks like a selfie stick with feet. Well, that's it is.
That's basically what it is, yeah. That's all it is. And I don't know that I would particularly recommend that stand. It has an awful lot of adjustments that don't necessarily adjust great. Other options are something that attaches to the edge of your desk and then is like a gooseneck.
Yeah, clamp. But they tend to move.
We have one of those, yeah. And it has other issues.
We have at least one of almost everything that we've tried this.
So I have found that stand, after fiddling with the adjustments and letting it stay still,
Judy,
seems to work the best.
Judy wants to know if is vertical the preference versus horizontal. That's a whole nother show.
Oh, well, the document camera I had being horizontal, so it fills the computer screen. I usually demonstrate the phone in vertical just because that's the way phones like to be held. It makes it clear that it's a phone. There are things in when I demonstrate that when I put the phone horizontal, some of the commands are hard to see. That's personal preference there. But I do believe that the camera that's showing on the computer should be horizontal because that fills the screen better.
Yeah, and it works better for me. I don't have to put stuff on the sides. All right. Well, that's us. Hello, everyone. I'm Jim, and here together with my wife, Chris, we are Geeks on Tour, and you can tell. Do you think your smartphone is smarter than you? And you have questions about your Apple iPhone or your iPad or your Android tablet or phone, and how do you learn about these amazing devices? Chris, how many you got there?
I just, in preparation for this class, I gathered all I have.
Enough.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There's one still over
okay,
there.
Okay, and how many are you using really right now?
Actually, I am fully using two.
Okay.
These
an Apple
these
and
two.
An Android.
An Apple and an Android, yeah.
Okay. All right.
So we are geeks who teach. That's what we like to do, and we think the best way to learn is in bite-sized pieces on a regular basis. So that's why we came up with this show, and all of the recordings are archived, are stored on our website, geeksontour.com. There's a ton of stuff there. A lot of it is free, and if you want everything, then we ask that you pay a little and become a member. geeksontour.com.
So what are we doing now?
Well, we actually got away for a whole week, I think.
Yeah, we were gone for a week.
We took the RV, our little road trek, to a road trek rally up in North Florida, and then we spent a couple days parked in a friend's yard. The friend is in the background there, but we go to see the donkeys. They're so sweet.
They are. They're wonderful. We want to say hi to our live viewers. A lot of our friends are out there. Bill and Karen, the Olive Cousins, Betsy, Catherine, Tracy, Bill. Wow. Janice.
John Aquino says, I remember meeting you at the computer club here in West Nyack several years ago. Yes.
Yeah?
Yes, up on the river there. It was some nice places to park an RV around there near Poughkeepsie.
Oh, yeah. Beautiful up there. And we even got to see the area where Washington Irving did his writing up from Mount Terry.
Oh, yeah, the cemetery.
Yeah, and the, yeah.
We had 14 solid years of full-time RVing around this country, and boy, there's some great stuff to see.
There sure is.
We're doing a lot of reminiscing this year.
Because we're not doing a lot of traveling.
Michael Daniels,
thank you, man. We really appreciate you.
And I do see one other question there.
Do you need to buy the license?
Right. And no, it is free, but then it pops up with ads. And especially if you are teaching, that's really annoying for it to pop up with ads. So it was only $10 for the license. I thought it was worth it.
Yeah, I think
for
so.
IV cam. I don't know about the others.
Right. Yeah. We'll have to try some of the others and see if,
you know. Oh, Peg, welcome. She says this is the first time she's made it live.
All right. Yeah, that's true. Like, all of these things are recorded and they're available, but we think it's fun to be here live. And it's a little scary sometimes. Like last week.
Yeah, if any of our members were with us last week, you know how bad internet can affect you. Because since we haven't been traveling, we turned off our
good Wi-Fi
hotspot
for
that
the rig.
We usually use. So it was not good last week.
And it showed. Oh, well. That's all right. So our beginner's lesson today, Chris, is what to do with old smartphones. And when you get a new phone, what do you do with the old one? I mean, there are a lot of things that you can do, but go ahead and use the chat and let us know what you're doing down there.
Yeah, everybody who's watching, I really would like to have you type in Yeah. You know, what do you do? We have six options. Do you trade it in?
Yes.
You know, that's probably the logical. If you get a new phone,
a lot of people do, yeah.
And you're still with Verizon, you take your old phone to Verizon, they take it and give you a deal on a new phone, and that's great. But
A lot of phones, you just stick them in a drawer.
Yeah, that's
depends on how you. Yeah,
these were all in a drawer. Yeah.
All right, recycle it. That's always a good thing to do. Take it to Best Buy; they'll recycle the stuff, or any of the big box stores like that, and you know you can get rid of it that way. That's a good, especially if it isn't working at all. You know, you can sell it. You can get some good money, especially for iPhones. They tend to hold their value really, really well. Or you can donate it. It can be a tax write-off.
Yeah, now, we've never sold any, as you can see. We still have all the phones we've ever had. But if I wanted to, just Google for where to sell my old smartphone, and you'll come up with lots of places.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You can give it to someone else. You can give it to a family member or a kid or something like that. And then they can learn how to use it. A parent, maybe.
Well, especially if you have grandkids. Are there any grandkids now that don't already have their own phone?
They already have their own
But phone. if they don't, you could give that to them, and then they wouldn't be tempted to spend all their time online because maybe they don't have an online connection with this old phone.
Or, yeah. You can repurpose it, and that's kind of like what we do with ours, some of ours anyway.
That's the main point of this show, is that there are things you can do with an old phone. You know, you can dedicate it to a different purpose. It's because what is an old phone? It just doesn't make phone calls, regular phone calls anymore. It still is an incredible piece of electronic equipment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
what do we got there? Some people.
Ron Whalen gives them to his wife. No, that doesn't happen. Well, you did give me one once.
Yeah.
Your Nexus or something when I wanted a Google phone.
Uh-huh.
A music player, yes. Music player is one of the things we'll talk about. Trading them in, sure. Depends on the value you get for it. You know, once you think about some of the other things you can do with it, maybe you won't decide to trade it in the next time.
Okay. I'm seeing a couple of comments out there. Somebody says, our picture is blurry. Well, it's not blurry for us.
Huh.
And we're looking at it on a couple of computers. It could be your bandwidth issue, and you know that's one of the things. Somebody else says Dave can't read the slides. Well, maybe that's because it's, I don't know. You have I'm not sure about your bandwidth, Dave. It's, you know, we don't have any control over your stuff. We only have control over ours, and today it seems to be doing pretty good. Okay, alarm clocks. I like that one. Usually traded in, gave it to one of my sons for some non-phone use. And we'll talk about some of those other non-phone uses. And use them as a music player. And you can sync. There's some L-Syncer. You can sync. Now, for a lot of these things, you do need an internet connection, at least for part of it. To get it loaded, to get the apps loaded, to do that kind of thing. But then a lot of the apps that we suggest, you really don't need an internet connection to make it work. Other things, Judy said geocaching.
Oh.
You might use it because they have a GPS in there. But you probably still need a data connection, either from a Wi-Fi hotspot from another phone that you've turned into a hotspot, or just a regular hotspot internet somehow for a lot of these things. Peg says, picture is clear as a bell here. Picture is good. Oh, thank you so much. It's nice to know because we can only try.
All right. Back to the slides.
Back to the slides.
So those are the things that we think are possible with an old phone. But regardless of what you do, I mean, especially if you're going to recycle or trade it in or give to a grandkid, you better wipe it off first. With computers, that was called formatting, remember? With phones, it's called resetting or factory reset or erase everything. And that you definitely want to do that if you're taking your phone somewhere else, either to recycle or to sell or to give to somebody else. But even if you're keeping it yourself, you may want to reset it because it makes it work better. If you are going to dedicate it to a single purpose, factory resetting, wiping it out, will make it work better for that one single purpose. If your phone has been stolen, I just want you to know that there is a way to remotely wipe your phone. So just kind of stow that away. If it ever happens to you, you can do that. And it's quite easy. So we have a little video, 6:59.
Hi, this is Chris Gold with Geeks on Tour. And this tutorial video is about doing a factory reset on an old Android phone. Now, I have a new phone. Everything is working great. I want to recycle or give this phone away. So I just want to completely erase it. I want to make sure that none of my information, none of my account info is still on this phone. You just go to settings and you find reset, backup and reset. I don't care about backing up. I know I already have everything I need. I have a new phone. So I just do a delete all data and restore default settings. Factory data reset. Reset phone. Now you do have to know the code to get into this phone. It won't let just anybody pick up a phone and delete all the data from it. So you that proves that you're the owner. I'm going to delete all. This phone will restart twice. Do not remove the battery. Reset. So that was the first reboot. Welcome. So this is just like it was brought out of the box from the store. You can, if you are setting it back up for yourself, you would go on from here. But if you're recycling it or giving away, you're done. So I turn it off. When I turn it back on again, it's just going to say, welcome. That is factory resetting your phone.
Yeah.
So I did a little bit of editing and cutting out some of the waiting time on that video, but not much.
No. And the iPhone is similar to that, too. The iPhone has another reset.
Very. Want to just show where it is. So on the iPhone, it's under Settings and General, and at the very bottom, Reset. And you can reset parts of it, but what I'm talking about is the erase all contents and settings. So that's how you do it with an iPhone. Do not think that wiping your phone means going to your contacts and deleting them, going to your photos and deleting them. No, 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 because what's happening there?
You're going to make a mess because it might sync. If it's still, you know, your contacts are something that is synchronized to the cloud so that you can get them from anywhere. And if you just delete your contacts, you might be deleting
your contacts.
That would not be good at
period.
All.
No. That's bad, bad. When you reset the phone, that's disconnected from your account. You're just wiping the phone. Whatever is in your backup cloud storage is still there and available to set up your new phone with.
Okay.
But do make sure that you know your account usernames and passwords. You know, this is actually another reason to keep your old phone around rather than trading it in. We talked to a friend this week who traded in her old phone and got a new one, and she thought she had got everything off of the old phone that she needed, and then she learned that the Google Authenticator does not reset up from the cloud. She needed to have her old phone, and she had lots of accounts set up in her Google Authenticator, which she now has to go back and recreate from scratch.
Yeah, and jump through all kinds of hoops.
Whereas if she had kept all her old phones like I do, she would have had that.
Yeah.
All right. Ron Brown asks, this is a good question, can you track your hiking afterwards to your Google Maps? We used to use an app. Oh, that was so cool. It was some kind of a tracker.
Yeah, and I'm sure there's others out there. We haven't used one in a while, but yeah.
Very likely you'll need a phone with an internet connection, but yeah, I don't know. If anybody else knows the answer to that one, that would be interesting.
And Ed wants to know, like computers, does it just lose the pointers when you reset a phone? I think it actually wipes some of the data. I think what you're talking about is when you reformat a hard drive, it's just resetting or when you delete a folder on a hard drive, most of the file is still there. Just the pointers to the beginning of the file have been changed to make that area on the hard drive available. But, you know, there are ways to actually unformat a drive or undelete files on computers. So
there, and there are some on phones too. If you might need to do a little bit more research if you are really concerned with security.
Yeah.
But doing the factory reset is good enough to me.
Okay.
Now, I also see somebody says they use theirs as a webcam on Zoom. So the same technique that I showed for using it as a document camera, all you need is a different kind of holder. If you have a different holder that will hold your old phone on your computer and it will be facing your face, then yeah, you can use it. Because these phones are fabulous cameras, right? That's what they're best at.
One thing to think about, though, is that the selfie camera is not as good as the rear camera. It might be just fine. I mean, they have, you know, plenty of resolution nowadays. But just knowing that the other camera is better. That came to mind because some friends have been doing some live performing. Like Facebook Live, some friends, musicians. And one friend of mine, Tom, the first time he did it with his selfie lens. And it wasn't great. It wasn't terrible, but it wasn't all, you know. And then the next time, I suggested, use the other camera. He turned it around, and he had a much better.
Right. So instead of having your phone on top of the computer and you can see yourself, what he's saying, that's using the selfie lens, better to set it so that it's using that lens. That lens is better. You can't see yourself, but you can see where to look.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's...
And, you know, if it was just a regular camera, you probably wouldn't be... I mean, just a regular webcam, you don't see yourself.
You wouldn't be seeing yourself.
Right, so it's same thing.
Okay.
Movavi... Screen recorder does a great job for recording this as I watch the New York Giants game on my TV. You don't have to record this. It's recorded for you on YouTube. All right. Throw it in the box and storage shed. You're not alone. All right.
So what do we mean by an old phone? I mean, I have phones here ranging... Was this the first one? Is this a droid?
It's a droid, yeah.
So this is like 2008. So that's 12 years old. Ancient history. And my most recent old phone is this one. This is about 4 years old. But if I went and turned in, if I got a new Verizon phone right now, this would become an old phone. Why? Because my Verizon number, which goes to this phone, would no longer be going to this phone. So what we're talking about is no service. no cell service or no SIM card. The SIM is what gives it a connection to a cellular company. So, big deal. If it's a still relatively new, I mean less than 12 years old, it probably can get Wi-Fi just fine. And using Wi-Fi, you can make phone calls.
Mm-hmm.
You can do anything with the internet. You can use Google Photos. So, you know, by an old phone, we just mean one that's been deactivated by your cell service.
Here's a use for a phone. You could use it as an emergency phone to leave in the car. You know, you can... Some law says that cell carriers must process 911 calls here in the United States, even for inactive phones. Now, it doesn't work on all old phones, but on most phones, especially if it had a SIM card, that would work. Now, so you want to keep it in the glove box. Keep it powered off to conserve the battery. Keep it charged as much as you can. And if you're in an accident, it can be used as a camera, take pictures of the scene. It can also be used as a music player, and you might be able to plug it into your radio speakers or use the Bluetooth that goes along with that. And it can be a good tool to have.
You know, it's kind of, why not?
Music?
Several people have said they use it as a music device.
Mm-hmm.
And if you have access to Wi-Fi and its Wi-Fi still works, then you can use streaming services like Pandora, but you do need Wi-Fi and you need a Pandora account for that. So you need to be able to set up. But if you transfer MP3 files to it, if you really are a music person and you have a lot of your own music, mm-hmm. you can put it on the device, either transferring it with the cable or over Wi-Fi. And from then on, you don't need any kind of connection. You can use it kind of like an old iPod.
That's pretty much exactly what it becomes. Pretty cool.
Now, the biggest problem with old phones is power.
Yeah.
So they don't hold a charge.
That's probably why one of the reasons that you're getting a new phone, because they just don't stay charged. And a lot of them today, you can't replace the battery easily. And so, you know, you get a new phone.
So any of these uses that we've been talking about assume that you have the charger and you keep it actually plugged in a lot of the time.
Yeah. Right.
Next, a Kindle book reader. If you want to read Kindle books, you know, or you want to give your grandkids a Kindle, you don't need to go out and buy a Kindle. Just give them an old phone with the Kindle app on it. And personally, I like reading on the phone. And just in case you don't, well, I'm going to try to persuade you here with a little video.
Hi, this is Chris Gold with Geeks On Tour, and I want to show you just a little bit about how using the Kindle app works. This happens to be on an iPhone, but it works about the same on an Android. So I'm talking about that app right there, Kindle. And any Kindle books that you have purchased through Amazon will show up when you open your Kindle app. I can see all of the books that I've ever purchased, or I can see just the ones that are downloaded on this device. To read a book, you just tap it to open it, and then you can turn the pages just by swiping that way or swiping back the other way. Or if you get a little bit of practice, you can even do it with one hand, because it's just tapping on that right margin there that turns the page. Pretty cool. And when you're done, you can just go back home and notice when I go back into Kindle, it takes me to the exact same place that I left off. What if you say, I'm not sure that this is readable for me? There are so many options for changing the text. You just tap on it, and now you see all the different options on the screen, and I'm going to tap on the AA. I can change the brightness, you know, depending if I'm out in the bright sunlight or I'm in a dark room. I can change it to be a black background with white text. I can make the text larger by tapping that. Or if your eyes are really good and you don't want to have to turn the page so much, you can make the text really small. I don't think so. So make that up. I like it about there. If you don't like the black on white or the white on black, they even have a couple more choices. There's sepia, which is black on a, and that is pretty easy on the eyes, or even a green color. Now let's say I want to look at someplace else in the book. You tap, and you can tap on the three-line menu, and here are all the table of contents. So if I know it's something in Chapter 7 I want to go to, there I am in Chapter 7. You can also highlight passages just by touch and drag. I have now highlighted that. And if I want to see everything I've highlighted, it's that item right there. So these are, I have already read this book and I highlighted lots of stuff in here. So if I wanted to go back and find something that I enjoyed in the book, I can find the highlight, go right to it. And that's just a little bit about using the Kindle app on a smartphone.
Yeah.
And once you have a book downloaded, you do not need any internet connection. So you could take an old phone on vacation with you or on the cruise ship that you're going to be on for a month, you know, download several books, and you do not need Wi-Fi or cellular for anything there.
Right. And Michael, you know, wanted to point out, and we said it earlier to explain that you don't need a carrier service. So you don't need service from a cell carrier, but you may very well need Wi-Fi of some sort. All these phones have Wi-Fi capabilities, so you, in order to connect to the internet. So some of the things that we're talking about always need to have an always-on internet connection as well as power. And some of the things like the Kindle app only needs the Wi-Fi or an internet connection only when you're downloading the books to the device, right?
Yeah, so our main point here is when you get a new phone and you now have an old phone, the only difference between the new phone and the old phone is that the old phone doesn't have the cell service.
Right.
And it still works on Wi-Fi. You can do everything except for when you don't have a Wi-Fi connection. And even then, there's plenty of things you can do. So.
And Warren said he had to send his old phone in for repair, and he was glad he had an old... I mean, his newer phone had to go in for repair. He had an old phone to use while that was gone. Yeah, there is a way to reverse selfies, and most of the apps now handle that just fine. J.B. Morrow uses it as a throttle on his model railroad. That's a cool app. There's so many things that you can do with it.
Remote control for your drone.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, there's all, I mean, there a remote control for certain audiovisual devices, TVs and Rokus, and that's how I access my smart home is on an app with my smartphone, but it doesn't have to be my current smartphone. I have a tablet set up. It's not a phone, but it's a tablet. Same thing,
you know.
A phone without a cellular connection is basically a smaller tablet.
And you can Velcro it to the wall, and so you have all your light switches right by the door.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to depend on A or G understanding what you say. Okay,
right.
Couple more.
All right.
Couple more slides.
All right. Camera and other static apps. So what do you mean by static?
By static, I mean that it's an app that's on the phone, and it once it's on the phone, it does not need any kind of internet access. It doesn't need any cell service or Wi-Fi, and it doesn't need any account. So if you completely wipe a phone it's still going to have the camera because that's something that comes from the factory. So the camera app on the phone will be there. And if you know a kid that wants to take pictures, cool. You don't have to buy him a camera. Just give him your old phone after you've wiped it and of all of your stuff. Now, you might want to connect it to Wi-Fi just long enough to download a couple of games or something and make sure that they are games that do not need an internet connection. And then, in fact, I even read somewhere that the Game Boy, you know, Game Boys that you have to have all controls, you could use one of these really old phones that had real keyboards and this little button that had up, down, left, right, and you can install a Game Boy app on there, and they, I don't know. That's a little bit, that's beyond me, but...
Flashlight. Hey, that's one of the greatest things about these phones. They are flashlights and magnifying glass. There are apps that are magnifiers, but some people just use the camera.
Mm-hmm.
Games, like you said.
Yeah, as long as they're not multi-user internet games. And even those you could use if your device does have a Wi-Fi.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. A remote for a Chromecast. So I have the Netflix and the Amazon Prime videos and the YouTube all set up on my phone. You know, sometimes I watch it just on the phone, but usually I will cast it to the big screen TV. But what if I'm away and Jim wants to watch those things and they're not set up? How about a dedicated old phone that you just leave by the TV that has all those things? It's a lot easier than going to each letter with the arrow keys on your real TV remote.
Okay, here's one that answers a couple of the questions.
Some people
that
been talking
there.
About this. Yeah.
Yeah, let Alfred watch your house. Now, Alfred is an app that we've done a couple of shows on, or at least pieces of our shows on it. It needs power. So you need two phones. So one is the camera and one is the viewer. Now you can have multiple cameras too. Needs power, needs Wi-Fi because you're going to leave it on. It's a great dog sitter. So somebody asked, and this is the story that I tell, that, you know, we were doing a seminar at a rally and all these people are out there. They had a hotspot in their RV, or they had an internet connection somehow through the Wi-Fi in a park or something like that. But they want to keep an eye on their animals and or make sure that their air conditioner is working, that kind of stuff. Alfred is a great tool for it. It actually sets it up so it's like a regular security camera. So you can check that out. It's free. You need a Google account for it, but most of us have Google accounts. That's free too. You can pay $4 a month for premium, and that gives you some extra features. It has all kinds of tools there, though. Did we go to the website? We wanted to go there.
No.
Okay.
Don't need to.
All right. But check this out. This one is really, really cool. I've used it for years. And
now, if you need a real security, if you have a real security issue at home and you're going to be gone for months at a time, I don't think I would depend on this.
No, I would get a real security camera system. The Orbi is a good one. There are several out there.
Just because if your router goes down, your camera doesn't work anymore. You know, somebody has to come and restart your
right.
router, or if the power goes out, and you don't have any service to call. So, you know, it's great for temporary, like the dog cam in the RV. You just point it at the thermostat, make sure your
just
dog is cool enough.
And that's the way we've done it. And other people have done it, and it's worked out great for them. All right. Audience ideas. We have quite a few good ones out there.
Yeah.
And using airplane mode, turning on Wi-Fi, actually get a better phone connection. than two bars of Verizon in his area. So using the phone on Wi-Fi or using the Wi-Fi as your phone connection. Not all phones do that. Most of them do now, though. And the KSA, the CASA app to turn on and off the remote switches. Right. Yeah, I have a Wink Hub here in our house. And that works great. So, tools for that kind of stuff. But, all right. Well, any other questions real quick? I don't see anything.
I think we've got it.
Did you learn something? Chris loves quizzes, you know. and so she thinks that everyone in the world should love quizzes too. But to erase an old phone, you should A, factory reset, delete all contacts and photos, or format.
Factory reset is what it is. Go manually deleting things, because that deletes from your accounts. So the factory reset is the way to clear off an old phone.
To use Alfred as a house security cam, you'll need an old phone and the Alfred app. Then the phone needs a constant supply of what?
Power and internet, Wi-Fi.
Right. True or false, any old smartphone that can be powered up can be a camera.
Pretty much true. I mean, unless the camera lens has a crack in it or something like that, but any old smartphone, turn it on and you have a camera.
All right. True or false, an old phone can be a Kindle reader without Wi-Fi.
Well, this is a little bit tricky. You have to have Wi-Fi to download the books. But once they're... And actually, there might be a way to cable to a computer. I don't know. I haven't done that. But to read the books that are already downloaded, you do not need any kind of a connection.
Okay. And what do we mean by old smartphone? A, older than 2 years. B, one where the service has been deactivated.
What we're talking about is just... when the service has been deactivated.
Yeah, Chris actually has a newer iPhone, but it doesn't have any cell service.
Yeah.
So she considers that the same as an old phone.
This is like an old phone, yeah. I just never got a SIM card for it because it's working so great on Wi-Fi, and I never leave the house anymore. When I do leave the house, I take my Android Verizon phone, but in the house I'm using my new little iPhone with no SIM card, no service at all. Kind of fun.
All right. The app we use to turn a phone into a document camera is
IVCam.
IVCam.
That's what we use.
And it's not the only one. Somebody earlier said that they use DroidCam, and that works basically the same. There are other apps out there too, both free and pay for. Want to remind everybody about our Backstage Pass. It's normally for our premium members only. It's an online Zoom meeting after the show. The link is in the email, or if you are a member, you can go to our geeksontour.com webpage and go to the member login. You'll find it there.
One new question.
All right.
Richard Clarkson asks, does the reset clear out your email address from the phone but leave it on your account on a new phone? Yes, exactly. It wipes the phone, but where are your actual email addresses? They're in the cloud under your account lock and key, your username and password. So, yes, exactly.
Okay. Cool. So, Chris, what's the webpage that lists all of our YouTube shows?
Geeksontour.com, and the menu item is YouTube Show.
And the webpage that lists all of our recent newsletters?
Geeksontour.com, and the menu item is Blogs and News. You'll find newsletters, 12, 13 years worth of newsletters in there.
Been doing this a while. She started when she was 4. We do invite you to become a member. Just go to geeksontour.com and click on the link there. And the Backstage Pass, we just talked about that. I think that's enough for us this week. I'm Jim.
I'm Chris.
And we are Geeks on Tour. Thank you all to our friends who came and joined us and We just really appreciate you guys. Be well, stay safe, and
keep pressing those buttons.
Yeah.
Ask, what does this button do?
What does this button do? Don't touch that button. Get away from me.
That's how you learn. It won't blow up. I promise.
She promises.